Okay.
Okay, and my video I think is showing. I hope it is. Good evening, everyone. It is Monday evening here in Chicago, Illinois, and I am very excited to have another session, to host another session of my TIE 575 class from National Lewis University. And it's been my pleasure to have various guest speakers join us each week to kind of give us an overview of their beliefs about professional development. This course is specifically focused on staff development, and we have about 10 people in the class, and they all have kind of varying degrees of experience and interest in this, I think. And the course is building towards a final project where people are going to be doing a benchmark project. And so the idea is that my students will glean ideas from these guest speakers and then apply it somehow to their final project when we get to that stage. Tonight, we have some of my colleagues from the Apple Distinguished Educator Program. We have Kurt Klynen and Christine, what do you want to be called? Ryan DiPaolo?
Sure.
Okay,
yes.
Christine Ryan. Okay, Christine Ryan. And they are in Belgium, which is really exciting. Christine is American and Kurt is Belgium. And we're excited. We're going global tonight, so this is really exciting. We do have one more global one. We have a friend of mine from Australia who's going to be joining us in a couple weeks. So, but you guys are the first ones to be going global. So I'm going to start by, this is a conversation and a show and tell kind of thing. Nothing, you don't have to do anything fancy. But I want to start by asking you guys, tell us about your careers, your background, and the ADE program. I think that's something that might be kind of new to the people in the room.
Okay, I'm glad.
Okay. My background is a career I joined the education space in 2005, taught math a career in tech ed school. And my very first day of teaching, the school was rolling out a one-to-one program, and I had to really think about how technology was going to be used in the math classroom. And from there, I taught there for 5 years, and then I left and went to a small public school district outside of Philadelphia called Jenkintown, where I interviewed for a math position, but my technology use was so great, they asked me to be the technology teacher. And there, I revamped their entire technology program into a digital media arts and design program. And then I left Jenkintown to join String Theory Schools for the past 3 years, as an administrator, as the director of innovation and professional development for String Theory. And we decided to throw out the textbook and say goodbye to all supplies and textbooks and go one-to-one with iPad and iTunes U. So I was the lead on the project for driving iTunes U, working with teachers every day on professional learning, writing curriculum, and bringing that curriculum alive and kind of visual in iTunes U. And now I'm taking a small hiatus and looking for some opportunities in Europe or around the world at an international school.
Yeah, and for me, the short version is I teach from 2.5 to 65 plus. I started out as a PE teacher, then ended up in elementary, then learned station work by a 4-year-old when I was in kindergarten, and then took a little sidestep to special needs. Then ended up at a middle school. Then they asked me to become the responsible person for the responsible person for all the training for the public schools in Belgium. And then I got questions to do that in other schools, in Catholic schools, private schools, international schools. So I started a nonprofit, just kind of like a joke, like doing something once a month. And that once a month turned into once a week into a 24/7 thing. And then I got across Belgium outside of the borders, and then Apple asked me if I wanted to come help them out, my classroom experience, to tell the stories and do like little coaching, and that's how I ended up in professional learning. I still work in a school for 5 hours, officially as a Dutch as a second language. My focus more is now on the team of 25 people now who want to share their experiences in classroom and how they use technology and how we can help other schools.
We're both Apple Distinguished Educator. I became an ADE in 2009 when Apple recognized me for the work that I was doing with technology in a math classroom and bridging the gap between career and tech ed and how technology could tell the stories of the connection to math and real world. And Kurt?
Yeah, for me, I became an Apple Distinguished Educator in 2006. Actually, started with a project I was doing called Talking Trees. At that time, there were no iPads yet. I was on MacBooks, the little white ones. And I was focused on mobile learning a lot at that time. And we used iPods to make tour guides. So when you were standing in front of the tree, I had recorded the sounds in the forest with the kids. So we did a little music, we did research, we had cameras out, and then we made those little podcasts. And then someone in Belgium got me into contact with Apple, and that's how one thing led to another. And then getting to know these Apple Distinguished Educators all over the world, that's like a rapid fire of ideas and like finding a tribe of people who inspire you to look differently at education and to try out new things.
And since then, we've been to several ADE institutes, definitely everyone since 2009, and several global ones. And for us, that's some of the best professional development that we participate in. That's kind of where we, as Kurt's talking about, going to find our tribe and the people that we work with. It's how we know Lucy, and we're so lucky. And that's how our professional development really kind of comes about as one of the ways that we go and learn with the global community. So we're very, very fortunate to be involved in that.
It's changed my life. I mean, I became one in 2005, and back then I think it was the last class that you had to be nominated by somebody at Apple. You couldn't just apply on your own. I think that in 2007 they changed that. Yeah. And so I'm glad it's a more open process now, because I think it's more fair, in all honesty, to mm-hmm. have people apply and be judged on their own merits than have to be funneled in. So that the application process is open right now, and it's every 2 years. And these summer institutes have been, the first one I went to was in San Jose at a fancy hotel, because I think Apple had was going to cancel a meeting and the ADEs took it over or something. The next year it was at a college. I think it was at Monterey State, and we lived in the dorms. In 2009, it was in Florida. Mm-hmm. 2011 was in Florida at Full Sail University.
And then 2011 was Phoenix. We were in Phoenix.
Oh, that's right. There was two. I think I skipped one. I missed one in there.
Yeah, I think 2010 was the first one they did that was an in-between new class one.
Okay, so that must have been in Florida, and I didn't go to the second one. Then 2011 was in Arizona at the Graduate School of Journalism at ASU. Mm-hmm. And then I didn't go for a while until the anniversary one, which was in San Diego, and was a huge one. But what's exciting about this for people who are listening is that Apple brings in some pretty unusual people that I don't think I would ever be exposed to otherwise. Mm-hmm. At the last one we had the person that used to work for the EPA, but she's now head of all of the green stuff at Apple, talk to us. And we had this E.O. Wilson, who is this 95-year-old biologist who's, world famous, and he had written some textbooks that are in iBooks for iTunes, and so he came actually and talked to us, and we had the person that did the illustrations for the book, who's a MacArthur genius, talk to us. And so there's some really high level interesting people that we've gotten to know at these institutes. And the other thing about finding your tribe, I also identify with that, because I felt back in 2005 the school I was in kind of alone. I worked in this big school. not everybody was so digitally savvy or interested, I guess. And one of the lessons I've learned over the years is not everybody is as excited about all this as we are. And, so to find my tribe, to find people who challenged me, who actually were, did much more amazing things than I could ever even dream about, and to be around them and to soak that all up, I think has been a huge part of my professional development. I think the world opened up for me when I became an ADE. The other thing that happened too was in 2006, we actually went to Europe. And yeah, this is before... before they did all those European, before they did a regular, you know, global institute. And this was more of a trip over 10 days. We went to Europe and we went to Berlin and Prague and wrote a global awareness curriculum. And EF Education was the partner on that. And the idea was that there were going to be these iStory tours that came out of it. People were going to take students and or teachers and go abroad and do digital media. And that never really transpired. I think a couple people did, like Mike Searson, and another guy did a couple with her with college students, but it never really transpired into a formal program. But it was like going to Europe with like 70 of your best friends. It was hard to do a lot of work then because we were all having such a good time and you know, making podcasts and interviewing people and taking pictures and whatever. So we were doing productive stuff. We just to actually create the lessons while you're on the road with the bandwidth at the time and most of the hotels was not good. And it was also hotter than hell. So we weren't terribly motivated to get our work done until we got home. But it was life changing for me too because I hadn't been out of the US a ton until then. And I thought, why are we not connecting classrooms more? You know, we have the technology, we have Skype, we have iChat, we have iMessage. Why are we not connecting classrooms more? So that's that. My global work really kind of was born out of that. But if you guys are interested, the people who are listening, if you're interested in this ADE program, I put the link in the chat. It's higher ed as well as K-12, and the application is open. And I don't think we have to do a video this year, right? There's no. I don't know if
the new class does.
Yeah. Okay, but we don't. Oh, good.
No. Okay. The alumni doesn't have to.
Okay.
And it closes on the 15th.
Okay, so it's coming up soon. Go ahead, Anthony. Oh, go ahead.
I was gonna ask. So I've never looked into this into this in depth before. I was wondering what it takes to become an Apple Distinguished Educator. I see that there's an application, but I see on here it's like for educators who are using Apple products in innovative ways in their classrooms and things like that. So I work for, you know, Nashville Lewis. We don't particularly use, you know, Apple products in the classroom. We had the iPad cohort that kind of failed.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. So it's interesting that you mentioned this, Anthony, because one of the first ADEs was a technology and education professor years ago. He's now retired. Her name's Marianne Handler. And she was actually one of my professors when I went through this program. And she was a big advocate for Apple. And I think there was more Apple in general within the university at the time. I didn't know that there was an iPad cohort that went through. I wish I had known about that. And then there's another ADE, Bruce Alborn, who has done adjunct work for Nashville Lewis. He and I actually used to teach a face-to-face course together a long time ago, and now he works for Apple Professional Learning. There are a lot of ties from Nashville Lewis to the ADE program. Helen Hoffenberg, who was an ADE, and then she worked for Apple. She's also a graduate of the technology and education program like a long, long, long time ago. So, to answer your question, I'll let Christine and Kurt answer it, but just, you know, you have to be doing things that are kind of, I think, innovative. I think they do like people who are doing stuff with iBooks and iPads in particular, but Christine and Kurt might be able to talk about this a little bit more.
Definitely, I think Apple's looking for the ways in which Apple technology is transforming classrooms. And I think that it really is kind of the show of how the technology itself, but also the applications with the technology are making a difference in teaching and learning. So it's a tough vetting process. It's very competitive. I would say there's a lot of applications that come through and they're looking for really dynamic stories. Kurt and I both served on that Apple Distinguished Educator Advisory Board, and we were also both people who vetted applications for the program, so we could really see as the applications came through, just what are the stories that kind of really make you think about teaching and learning in a different way. So,
the other thing too is that there's some people who I thought for sure would get it. Like there's somebody I interviewed for an award for Chicago Public Schools I thought was going to be admitted in the last class, and she wasn't. So like I was really surprised. It's not necessarily a done deal for some people who are amazing.
And for some people that have a brand, if you know, just because you're a big name and a big brand doesn't guarantee you entry into the ADE program. It's really about the work you're doing and the story that you can tell about the transformation of teaching and learning with Apple technology.
And Anthony, it doesn't, there's one ADE that is actually a classmate or a colleague of Cody's, Corey. Corey is one of our students in the class, and Corey is a technology coordinator at Lake Forest High School. And one of his colleagues, who I'm blanking on his name because I've never met him, is an ADE, and it's actually a Chromebook high school. But his colleague, who's an ADE, is what is his name? I have to think of it. He's a media teacher. So he's using Apple stuff in his lab and that sort of thing in pretty innovative ways, even though the school's not completely Apple. So I think it really depends on, you know, what's actually going on in your classroom, and again, to that story that somebody might tell.
Yeah.
And it's not always the best fit for everyone. And I don't know about you, Lucy, but in 2009, I also became a Google certified teacher. So there's some opportunities for professional learning along the lines of Google Apps for Education, which is now G Suite. And you can apply to be a Google certified trainer by going through the trainer program, which I just completed. So I just became a Google certified trainer. I was awarded a Google certified teacher certificate in 2009, and now I'm a Google certified trainer. So there's different kind of venues for that kind of professional learning. There's tribes that run along in the Google Apps thread too.
The other thing to think about the tribe factor is you can make your own tribe. You don't have to belong to an elite program like this. I think the chances of getting to be an ADE are really, it's hard.
In the group over here. So the nonprofit that I'm running is definitely not just ADEs. I look for people with good classroom experience on the use of technology and then bring them together. And yeah, granted, some of them become ADE because they want to apply and they like to work with Apple technology, but some of them work with Google and they challenge each other. So it's almost like feeding on each other and making each other better.
And there is a certain amount of competition, I think, in these groups too. I mean, not in an obnoxious way, but in a way that makes you be the best that you can be. With the Google stuff, guys, there's other, Discovery has an elite teacher group too, and different levels.
Lots of places you can find a tribe, right? So it depends on like what you're doing and what kind of tools you're using in the classroom and all the different, there's tons of them, tons and tons.
I'm trying to think what the other one that I was going to suggest too. I'll find the Discovery Education link too, but there's, you know, there are a lot of people also who like to add all of these distinctions to their signature and their email, which drives me bananas, like when they have like 20 things after their names.
So true.
Yeah. And you know, I think what the bottom line is that I think you hit on something earlier, Christine, that the ADE program are people who are on the ground in their classrooms doing the work. They're not necessarily the people who are trumpeting how wonderful they are all the time. It's really interesting because a lot of the people who become ADEs I've never encountered before in my life. And so that's kind of interesting. Anyway, the Google program, that's changed a lot. that started, I got involved with it in 2006 or seven when they did focus groups in New York and Chicago and San Francisco. And it was one Googler's 20% time. She, you know, I'm not sure if Anthony and Kelly are familiar with this, but every person that works for Google has 20% of their time to devote to a personal pet project that benefits the common good or the company in some way. And this woman, her name was Kristen Ferdella. This was her baby. And she moved in, she was in marketing, and she moved to a couple different places within the company. And in one place, anyway, after these focus groups, she decided to do this Google Teacher Academy model where people came to Google for a day and got trained and then became Google certified teachers. And that was it was like maybe two or three people running this program. And Kristen shifted from one place to another within the company. And she finally kind of found the right fit with Google Apps. At the time that I did the focus group, Google had just bought Writely, and Writely became Google Docs. So all of this was like really on the ground. And my favorite story about that was the woman that was helping her with these focus groups, I asked her, oh, so you work for Google? And she goes, no, I'm a journalism teacher in California, and my daughter works for Google, and I'm just helping out. And I Googled her daughter, and her daughter, the Google started in her daughter's garage.
No kidding.
Yeah. And her daughter has now had a YouTube, and her other daughter was married to Sergey Brin. And so they have this lot, you know, big Google legacy there. And Esther is also just a kick-ass teacher in general, still teaching at Palo Alto High School and being a champion for it. Yeah. So it was this kind of, you know, on the ground thing back in 2006. And now they probably have over 100 employees. The Google Certified Teacher Program is now called the Google Certified Innovator Program. It's like the AD program, you apply, but they have more cohorts every year. They probably have two or three cohorts a year. And then anybody can be part of the training process and become a trainer if they pass these exams. And I've kind of lost track of what's what. I mean, it's gotten a lot more convoluted with Google, I think.
Yeah, it's more of the training. The exams that you take and pass are really just kind of deep dives into like the tools and how to use them and make sure that you know how to do those. And then you're required to do, I think, 12 trainings a year, meetups, trainings. So you have to document that over the course. And then your certification is good for 2 years, and then you have to renew it.
Okay. So,
it's a lengthy process. But a good challenge if you're trying to challenge yourself in terms of your own professional learning and you're using Google Apps for education in your classroom, it's a good challenge to take on, like for to kind of drive your own professional learning in that way. So we've done some of the trainings with all of Kurt's trainers. We had a Google Apps certified trainer day where we were all studying together and again, that goes back to your tribe, like kind of finding like-minded people who want to do that you can kind of put this professional learning community together and study with and do lots of other great things with too.
The other thing that's new too, that maybe Christine and Kurt, you've done more with this than I have, but they now have a badging program with Apple that seems to be taking off. I think I put the link to it up here. Do you guys have it in Europe yet? The Apple Teacher Program?
Everywhere but Belgium.
UK, Ireland, the Netherlands. Not Germany, not France, because it's not translated. There's some problems with legislation, things like that, translations. So some countries in Europe, yes, definitely. But it's still in English in those countries too.
Yeah. And to become an ADE or to apply to any, as an alumni to apply to the institutes, you now have to have your badges for Apple Teacher.
Ooh, I better get going on it then.
It's hard. You have to be an Apple Teacher. It's time consuming, but it's not terribly hard if you're familiar with Apple technology. It's fairly straightforward. Yeah. Yeah, you badge for the Mac and you badge for the iPad too.
So and then the iWork and the iLife, as we know them. So iMovie, GarageBand, Pages, Keynote, Numbers. Mm-hmm. There's one specifically for Swift now too.
Oh, really? Okay. That's probably why the least I know of. It's the link Anthony is up on is up here. It's the apple.com/education/appleteacher. It's their website, and it's really simple. It's not some fancy platform. We are going to do another session in a couple of weeks with a platform called Chrome Warrior that I've used with Q events, and it's you can design your own challenges and a badge associated with them, and it's about $20 a user. And so I think like, if you're looking for something like Anthony, I can see you with your training at the university using Chrome Warrior. But you could use Apple Teacher too. Like why it gives a nice baseline usage for people. And
even not the training, even the training documents for Google as well. Even if you're not going to take the test, just the training and the studying documents are really great for professional learning. And Google's done a really nice job of making sure that there's some good.
So why reinvent the wheel, I guess, is, you know, why make up your own training materials when these exist?
So I guess something that we've been struggling with, or not really struggling with, we've kind of looked into badging here at National Lewis in the past.
Yeah.
But I think the issue that we ran into is that we really want to make those badges meaningful.
Yeah.
So, you know, we can badge in D2L, we can add badging onto our performance management system that our HR office uses.
Yeah.
But we really want the ability for, you know, people to show off their badges and for us to go to these people and say, hey, these people have earned these badges and we can trust these people because, you know, we've awarded them these badges for X, Y, and Z. And we just really haven't found, a platform to do that.
Well, part of the problem is Mozilla was the platform to do that with.
Yeah.
And you could put your stuff in the backpack, the Mozilla backpack, and then use it in other places. It was supposed to be open source and that you could be able to transfer those badges someplace. And they're not doing it anymore. The one thing I would say that there's going to be a badging event. And Anthony, I don't know if anybody sends you to conferences or anything, but there's a badging summit at ISTE. And there's some badging in Participate, which we talked about last week too. So you might want to look in there. That's the only thing I can think of. Christine and Kurt, do you have any ideas?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things we're working with a school in Lisbon right now, and part of the process that they're going through is badging. So they created, what we did is we helped them around their school district goals and mission for the year. And we looked at what their mission and vision was for the year that they were trying to accomplish. And with that as the guiding principles, we helped them outline an iTunes U course that was delivered to all the faculty. And they did a really nice job of presenting challenges to the faculty around the mission and goals for the year. So math was one of the goals. So we gave a challenge, and for every challenge that the teachers complete, they get a badge. But they also have an interesting kind of concept at their school.
Yeah, they use houses. So they've got four houses linked to famous inventors or people from history. So it's a little bit in their culture, and you can see them starting to do the math in it, because the badges that they earn, sometimes they have to work with someone from another house, and some, if you can get your whole house to complete something, they can earn more points. So it's I've never seen the housing principle happen in a school other than Hogwarts. So it's really interesting to see what kind of effect it has on people and how motivated they get.
The interesting thing about the badging that they did is they actually kept it really simple. And I love the simplicity of the way that they did it. And one of their ed tech leads just went into a program to design his own badges. And it was just a quick,
He used Canva,
and he made individual badges for each challenge. Yeah. And then once each teacher completed them, they were emailed a badge for completing the task or the activity. So it's actually kind of cool to see it stripped back into something really simple, where the badges were created around the challenges, and then each badge gets delivered based on the challenges. So Canva's been really great for them, and it's nice to see like the simplicity of it. And, you know, Kurt and I talk a lot about that, about kind of going back to basics and not overdoing things when you can do them pretty simply. So that was a really nice way to deliver that.
Yeah. So D2L, if you're not familiar with it, is Desire to Learn. It's a big Canadian company that does online courseware. And just about everywhere I visited with my daughter in the last year for college visits, they're using D2L. So it seems to be the higher ed platform. The other thing I was going to say is I think Schoology has badging, and people have done things with that. And there's another ADE, Larry Baker, at Mercy High School, who I think has created badges for his PD in Schoology.
And yeah, Kelly, right, Edmodo has them too.
Edmodo's is pretty limited. I think I've done some work with Edmodo, and I think they could make it a little bit more robust. And then the other thing, and I'm trying to find it, there's the Gurnee School District, which is near us, and somewhere in the link that I'm providing there, it would not surprise, they're an Apple Distinguished Program. And they have a PD program in there that has like a world map or something in it. And there's different challenges for people to do. And I can't find the actual page that has it, but I'll look for it while you guys are talking. And it was actually kind of an interesting way to make, like, why can't PD be fun? And
while we're talking about that. Okay.
So I'll shut up. And why don't you tell us about your joy of professional learning and your iBook and everything like that. And we're excited to hear about what you guys have been doing.
So last year at the Global Institute, we came up with this idea, actually before that. Last year at String Theory School, I was leaving to go to a conference, and it was kind of summer, and they were making the plans for what the professional learning was going to look like in August. And I said, one of the challenges that I found in every school district that I'm in is that the administrative team doesn't really know what to ask for in terms of professional development. And they're always trying to scramble to come up with professional learning ideas and the ways in which they can deliver professional learning. So I made an iBook for the school to say, for me as the professional learning coordinator and the EdTech person, here was all the ways that I could deliver professional learning. I could do it this way, I could do it one-to-one, I could do it small group, we could do whole school. We could come up with these different ways. And from there, that kind of sparked an idea for a project that we wanted to work on. And we came up with the concept that it would be really cool to make professional learning books that are like recipe books. So we wanted to kind of create this idea of opening a recipe book. And so that's why we titled it The Joy of PL instead of The Joy of Cooking. So we designed it all around the ideas of the joy of cooking and innovative ways to deliver professional learning. So it's a team of really dynamic educators that was a global initiative. It was a global initiative that we started, and it took off. So the first book we made was for innovative professional learning, for people that have done a lot of professional learning but wanted to take it to a new level and really innovate with it.
Yeah, people who are tired of doing presentations, mm-hmm. and sitting through workshops where someone was standing in front and telling you like step by step what to do, and everyone having to follow the same speed. So just trying to find new ways. And then that was the first one. And then we took it back one step, saying like, okay, this was a book for us. We've been delivering some professional learning for the last few years. But what about that person that gets ripped out of a classroom and all of a sudden is the PL coach in school, and now you need to know how do you deliver a good presentation? If you're going to use presentation, at least know how to do it in a good way. If you're going to do a workshop, think about making it hands-on. And then a few other like simple ideas. So that's where we split it up in Basics 1 and Basics 2. And now the new one that's out, we reached out to the global community and said like, hey, probably everyone's doing something around the world. What are your experiences and things like recipes? Because we came up in our initial brainstorm with more than 70 ideas mm-hmm. of things that we could do. And it's small things like Sean from Ireland says he works in
high ed
for teacher trainees, and he uses PhotoStream. So some of his students teach on an island, and in order to get feedback, he lets them shoot little videos, put them in a photo stream, and then the people who have the feedback on that, which could be peers, but also the teachers from the university, can, in a private environment, comment on those videos. So it's small things like that where I think we can transfer that to any lesson. It's not necessary technology-based, because that was a question that we had in the beginning, like, is this a way, or are we teaching about accessibility? And that's not the focus. So any of the recipe could be linked to any subject that you're using. And what we are getting as feedback now is that teachers actually want to use it in their classroom as a different way. So let's see, like, we can do a speed dating activity, or we can do a Swedish fika. So there's all kinds of things in there that can be used as a different way of delivering content, but making it more fun than just an instruction or just a presentation.
And the reason we thought about it a lot is because we ask teachers to create engaging environments in the classroom. And we say, this is what learning should look like, and here's how it should be. You know, we should see engagement in your classroom. We should see these different models of learning taking place. But what we realized is that we don't provide that for teachers in professional learning. So we say, this is what we want you to do, but we haven't given you the experience of doing it. So how can I expect you to leave professional learning and not know without having an experience? So we talk a lot about teacher professional experiences and providing, we want to change that kind of professional development language, which always has that negative, like, oh God, I have to go to professional development. I'm going to sit and listen for 4 hours, to the idea of professional learning. Teachers are learners too, and we say that learning happens on a continuum, mm-hmm. and that learning is happening across all of the whole community that are involved in school. So how do we think about that whole community of learners, regardless of whether you're a teacher or a student or an administrator, and how do we deliver professional learning around the goals and initiatives that are happening within the school itself. So we really did spend a lot of time thinking about, you know, how can we transform this learning environment and make it much more engaging for the learners who are teachers.
Yeah. And the structure was built on a little bit of the time that you have as a teacher. Like the school we're helping out in Portugal, those people have a whole day, and then after school hours from 4:30 till 6:30, they sit through another, but they have another 2 hours for professional learning. But we thought about, what if you only have a car ride to school? What can you do to, like, I want to learn something? Well, maybe you want to consider, like, getting an Audible account and having a book being read to you instead of, or listening to a podcast, or following a webinar.
Like, so we talk about that. Yeah, you know, we've done book clubs. Like, I've done book clubs before as part of the professional learning, by providing a comprehensive list of novels and then asking teachers to choose one that they were interested in reading. And then we come back in August and then all the teachers find people that read the same book as them. So nobody knows who's reading what, but then you kind of come together with people that read the same book and you have a book talk, and then you share out, like, what were some of the things that you came away with? What were some of the things that you think you could bring to the classroom this year to kind of transform learning based on the book you've read? All the new teachers that we hired always start with Seth Godin's Stop Stealing Dreams. And if you haven't read Stop Stealing Dreams, the manifesto by Seth Godin, it's one of the best reads you can have. And especially people that are new to education, and people that are just, that haven't ever read it before. It's a phenomenal read, and it's free. You can get it online. Totally free. So within the books, we really thought about what Kurt's saying is, how much time do you have as someone who is organizing professional learning? Mm-hmm. How much time do the teachers have? And how do you how do you kind of change and differentiate the professional learning based on time? So we looked at time as the component and we said, okay, well, if you only have something that where you could do it in a few minutes, or you have a few hours, something that could take a few days, or something that is an ongoing professional learning. One of the professional learning recipes is about digital portfolios, and that's an ongoing professional learning. But to ask teachers to develop their own professional learning, professional portfolios, and we did it simple in Google Sites, but just because it becomes a reflective journal over the course of a year long, and saying, you know, what did you do this year, and what did you learn, and what did you contribute? So everything from, like, you know, a fika, which could give you, which could be 15 minutes of coffee and a conversation, to
using dice. Like I really love, and there's one of the books that's going to come, it's focused all on games, like either using dice, using board games in a different way, or cards. So there's a few things that come back when you look at games that we use throughout history. So I'm looking at how can that be used for professional learning.
Yeah, so we have some really cool app dice that we use, and we took it to ISTE last year, kind of as a fun activity for people to be able to participate in, and we found that they just really, really loved it. So we really started to think about how this could help too. And here I'll share the link with you. So you can buy the app dice in the Etsy store. But it's just really like rolling the dice and then using apps on the iPad to create a story or create content. And then the dice come with cards that have suggestions for them. They're really and it's all Kurt, to give credit to where credit is due. The designs are all Kurt's, the ideas, they're brilliant. And we took them to the ISTE playground last year, and people were absolutely like, where can I get these? And so we were like, okay, we'll put them up in the Etsy store, because we had so many requests that we thought it would be really cool to be able to do that. So it is that idea of the shifting PD professional development to, like, hey, how can we come together as this community of learners, and how can we have these great learning experiences? And that's a lot of the things that we've been working on for the past 6 months. This project with the ADE community that started in Berlin last summer. Normally you would do one thing and it'd be like one and done, and you'd publish for Apple and that would be it. But our team was so excited about doing this project, and with the ideation of over 70 recipes, you know, we said, well, why do we need to stop? We need to just kind of keep going and keep putting out this kind of these books for teachers to be able to use and come up with some cool ideas. And if you guys have any questions for us along the way, please feel free to ask. Or
does that place listed PD?
So Kelly's asking if this replaces your district PD, or does the district recognize it? And I'm saying that it's a guide to designing effective or interactive and interesting PD sessions more than anything.
Exactly. That's exactly what it is. So your district PD, whatever it is. So I was beholden to my district professional development, right? But we had to think about what were the goals and initiatives that we were going to embark on for the year. The school in Lisbon that we're working with said these were the goals that they set forth, and we said, okay, let's take those goals and design professional learning around it. So how does the professional learning help drive the goals and the mission and vision of school? So it's not it is not a replacement. It is simply a way to think differently about the way professional learning is delivered and how teachers engage with it based on the district goals.
And it's country different. I mean, like in Belgium, every school has only 1.5 day of professional learning every school year. So there's no student-free weeks at the end of the school year, or no coming in a week earlier at the beginning of the school year where there's no students and it's all about professional learning. So a day and a half is not a lot. There's some studies out there that show the amount of hours that you put up for professional learning and the actual results or learning profit that you get with your students. And anything below 14 hours of professional learning is going to result in 0 hours or 0% of learning with your students. So you need to get at least to like 49 or 50 hours a year where you invest as a professional. And I think any genuine professional in education wants to learn. I mean, you chose education, the business of learning. If you're not showing that you're learning, then yeah. I think you're setting a bad example.
I need to unmute. Yeah, I think that we always talk about our kids being lifelong learners, but what about the adults? You know,
yeah.
I think we're getting on that. A couple of things that come to mind when hearing you talk, I can't wait to dig into this more. Don Buckley, who Christine knows, and I are doing a workshop on using design thinking to design global experiences for a private school in Las Vegas at the end of the month. And he is, he likes games too. I'm going to show him what you guys have been up to because I think he'll like that. But the game that we're using at the beginning to get everybody kind of an innovative mindset, you guys might appreciate it. It's called Disruptus. And I have
Rashawn.
He does. Well, he teaches with Rashawn, so maybe he got it from Rashawn. I don't know.
It's coming out in our guest chef book.
Ah, okay, your guest chef book. I love it.
So yeah, we have the game. We have this. Yeah. We have it.
Oh, okay. So I need to order it and play around with it. Yeah. But there's I think the sense of fun and play, I think adults respond to it just as much as kids do. The other thing I would add about Don is well, Don and Rashawn are going to be doing one of these with us in a couple of weeks. Don, when he was at the School of Columbia, he would do something where I think a different administrator was in charge of professional learning every year. So when it was his year, it was the year of innovation. And they could do things like they didn't have to read a book, but they could subscribe to a magazine, or they did a pop-up within the school so the parents could see what modern learning looked like, or they would do all these different things, or he'd bring in people from that Kickstarter to do a lecture at the school.
Yeah.
And how do we think outside the box? I mean, I think that's the bottom line with this is like, why does professional learning have to be tedious?
And sit and get, and somebody flies and just drops whatever they need to drop on you. It's the same we were talking about with, we were talking about when we did the I-Chin-Ju project at String Theory, the administrative team said, we can't ask teachers to build courses if we're not prepared to do it. So all the administrators from the highest level of curriculum all the way down, everything went into courses. We were all building courses all year long. And even the administrative team delivered all of the things that they needed the faculty to have through an administrative course. So there was no emails going out anymore. If it was information was coming to you through a course, you never went to the front office for a paper again. It was all, so again, it's like thinking outside of the box, but like, how do you kind of curate the things that you need the faculty to have? So all of the fire drills, the lockdown drills, everything you needed the faculty to have was at their fingertips on a device. And we thought really differently about that, about not having that kind of central office where people need to go and get things, but rather than to give things and give all the necessary documents to teachers as they have it. So
it seems like it would save a lot of time too. We've done a lot of talking in this class about adult learning theory and treating adults, you know, as adults. The way that adults learn is different than kids to a certain degree, but how do we not condescend to teachers? I think that's a big piece of this. The other thing I'm looking here is like this iBook is really interactive. I just pointed my iPad because it was dead. I didn't realize it was dead. So I'm looking at it on my computer, and I'm looking like at the event generator, which I think I really, really need to be on the iPad to experience. Tell us about the interactive features of the iBook and how you designed this, because I think this is pretty cool. And by the way, I'm not sure if we have another student here too, Irene. And Irene is, just to give you a little background about her, she does cultural awareness kinds of after-school programming with schools in Chicago Public Schools as a business. So she's learning a lot that she can apply to her staff in terms of their training and that sort of thing. So she just joined us, and we're glad to have her. I don't know how many of you guys, of my three students who are here, have access to an Apple device where you can see these books. They're best on the iPad. If you guys want to respond in the chat, let us know if you guys can see these or not.
And then you can look them on. You can look at them on iPhone too, and definitely on an iPhone.
Okay. So anyway, tell us about the interactive features, because I think that's really cool.
Kurt was entirely responsible for design. We were like, okay, we'll give you the content, but you're the designer. So all the books are designed with his vision for interaction.
Well, they're beautiful.
Thanks. I like to keep them pretty simple and to the point. And then the interactivity, just where you need to have interactivity, going from that, I mean, I'm a gamer background. I grew up playing games, so a little bit of that integrated into a book where you have the pop-up when it's needed. And then maybe you can share a screenshot. I don't know. But the interactivity Lucy is referring to is in this case, in one of the books, is a conference builder, which is actually a basic template in a program called IAD Producer, which in the beginning says widgets for iBooks author. And I chose a blank one because I like to start from scratch. And then, believe it or not, Keynote is the program that I use mostly for making my designs at first and then exporting that as a photo. So I don't do a lot of Photoshop work. I'm not a designer, like as a true profession. So what I did over here in this conference builder was I took all the recipes and I just put a switch next to it. So when you tap the switch, you know that these are the things we're going to look at when you're building a conference in your school. And then in the next two books, I made a spin the wheel activity where you have a topic. I keep coming back to accessibility, saying I'm going to do a accessibility, and I don't know what yet. Could be an accessibility cafe, a genius hour. So you swipe through the recipes, you spin the wheel, and you choose a topic you're working on. And then you go to the recipe in the book. So just there, keep it simple too. And now my next challenge will be to get all those recipes into an app where you shake your phone and get more info. So
can you guys see my screen?
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, great.
Yeah, that would be awesome, like an app with this. I think that would be like the logical next step. I just think this is going to be incredibly valuable to the students in my class as they design some sort of PD activity, thing. This benchmark project that they're going to do is supposed to be online, theoretically. And I have to redesign it this week, basically, for accreditation purposes and so that they can also get started on it, because we're almost halfway through the course. So, I don't know. So is there anything specific to online learning in the book? Do we have all the links to all the books, by the way? And is there anything specific to online learning?
The iTunes course is in there too, where we're gathering all the books in now. So to kind of like, because it started out with one and then it became a series pretty quickly.
Which recipe were you asking for, Lucy?
Online.
Oh, online.
I believe in
Do we have all the links in the chat? That's what I, to make sure that we get to everything.
Yeah. Yep, no problem. Okay.
Okay, because I think there's so much stuff here, guys, for you to look at. So the other thing, NLU people, is that in iTunes, You may not be aware that there are courses. Not only is there music and books and movies, but there's also this section called iTunes U that's all free content. And Anthony, particularly for you teaching higher ed, I think you might want to take a look at this. So I can share my screen and show you what it looks like really quickly. Where is it? I have so many windows open. Here it is. Okay, so I'm going to share my screen for 2 seconds just to show you guys where this is. So this is iTunes, and on the left-hand side, you're going to, there's a pull-down menu that says iTunes U, and you can see courses that I've subscribed to already here on my Mac. And they're, again, they're better on your iPhone or on your iPad. And like, this is one on Swift Playgrounds on learning how to code. And if I were on my iPad, you could see it a little bit better, but you can make courses yourself. This could be a platform delivery method for you for your benchmark project, or you can search for, and I'm trying to think where I am going here. Let's see if I type in Apple Distinguished Educator. There's a channel with all this ADE stuff in it. I want to go to the store. I don't want to go to my library. That's what I want to do. So here's all the stuff in iTunes U that's free. A lot of it's higher ed, but there's all this K-12 stuff as well. And so what they're saying is that there's a course that they've developed in here. So if we typed in, if we searched for Joy of Professional Learning, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All their stuff should come up.
Yep, there they are.
Yeah. So there's their course.
And then
the three books.
Books, yeah.
So the course looks like this, and it's going to lead you through everything.
Yeah.
It has all the materials there. Oh, that's totally awesome. And you guys can go in there and leave them a really great review too.
That'd be nice.
So quick question. Is there any way, say that a faculty member or staff member doesn't have an Apple device, is there any way for them to access these resources?
So that's part of our the next work in our project is we're going to take the books and make them into PDFs. It just takes a little bit of reworking because we have to take the interactivity out of them for you to be able to see all of the things that are there. But it's to take them and then publish them in Amazon and on other platforms for people to use if you don't have an iOS device.
So that's great. I just thinking of that because I know I've been working with our faculty for about 2 years now, and every time I tell them that I want to show them a resource that they can't use, I know that a large portion of our faculty won't have an iDevice, device, unfortunately. Yeah. They just give me like the saddest look on their face.
Yeah.
And I have to then point them in some other direction.
Yeah,
it is a challenge. You can look at the nice thing about the books is you can view them on any Mac too. So
the books look great.
Apple devices,
fantastic.
Thanks.
The other thing too, I think you can export them in iBooks to a PDF or an iBooks Author.
Yeah. You can, but you lose the interactivity, and so some of the things are hidden.
Yeah. Okay.
Right, and so we have to unhide. Like, there's pop-ups that are like narratives and stories from the authors who wrote the recipes. So we have to move them out into like sides, so you get to experience that in a kind of a flatter version.
Yeah. Is this, it's 44 pages. Is that like a lot of content? Because I actually run, or I help run a monthly book club that we have. I'm thinking maybe this would be an option.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, it's. The thing I needed to do now is that because of the pop-ups are in there, to have it in a way that I've designed it, and that's where I get pretty particular. Got to look and feel, and I want that PDF to get as close as possible to this interaction you have with this book. I have to take the personal stories out and create a separate page, and things like the event generator won't be in there. So it's going to be a reworked version. But it's definitely possible. I'm looking at EPUB and or PDF.
Yeah, so it's like changing the event generators to a more static idea where you could check them off, or you could write, you know, you could annotate the book, and then that would give you some of the same features. It just it loses the interactivity. So yes, that's part of our project. That's part of our ongoing project.
You know, Anthony, if I could redo everything the way that I wanted at NLU, It would be to have some sort of like the IPAG. I have no idea what you guys did with an IPAG cohort, but I would try that again. I was just at a teacher education conference in California that was run by an ADE, and I met those Irish ADEs, Sean and I can't remember what the other woman's name. The woman's name was, but they were. Is it Sinead? I can't remember what her name was. I'll think of what it is. It's something very Irish. It's occurred to me. Anyway, what they did was they were doing teacher portfolios in iTunes courses.
Yeah.
And there's amazing video capabilities, Anthony, where you can annotate the videos and leave notes at particular points and things like that. And it made me realize that I haven't been paying enough attention lately to the whole Apple ecosystem and how to be involved, you know, to really invest in that provides a pretty rich environment. That was one takeaway from it. But the other piece of it was the program that was really sponsoring this teacher conference is Cal State Teach, which is an Apple Distinguished program. It's like the ADE program, but for an actual school or program. And this is kind of a remote teaching program with teachers. Like it's all, I think most of it's virtual. And then sometimes they meet with their supervising teachers and that sort of thing in all over California. It's kind of it's not an alternative certification program, but it's a little bit different than traditional university programs. And so every student teacher and every faculty member gets an iPad. And it makes it a lot easier for somebody like you, Anthony, when everybody's kind of invested in the same device. If I were, you know, I wish National Lewis would go out on a limb and do something like that and really invest in something, because then you can focus on the teaching and learning and not get distracted by which device is, you know, is needed and that sort of thing. I'm just kind of babbling here, but I was really impressed by how some of these schools of education were using Apple iPads in particular.
Yeah.
Oh, no, you're absolutely right. I think NLU, everything has to be done by committee. I really wish someone would just make a decision. Hey, we're going with this. And I would do my best to make sure that happens.
Yeah, let's be gutsy. You know, what do we have to lose? And you know, I think colleges of education in general have had a hard time innovating in comparison to K-12.
Yeah, agreed. I think that's what we're saying too. We were worried about the kids that were leaving string theory schools with no 4 years of no books. 4 years of everything delivered to them on an iPad, and what did that look like in the university setting when they were used to having all their content? And we said one of the beautiful things about using iTunes U and that we loved about it, and it's the work now that we're doing with Park International School, is that content follows the kids. So there isn't a time when you pull content back and you take content. We take textbooks back. We're like, thanks for coming. Give me my resource back. With iTunes U, the content follows the kids for their career. So they always have the reference and they always have whatever they need moving forward. And we really loved that aspect of it, that they could refer back to all the courses that they had taken before.
This is awesome. You guys have been wonderful. Now it's 2:00 in the morning in Belgium. And you guys I hope you don't have to get up in the morning. And there's our other ADE, Carolyn Skibba. Hi.
Hey, everybody. Oh, my gosh. I didn't believe you. I can't believe you guys are doing the Midnight Jet Lag Express on this. Oh, that's awesome.
It's awesome. And I cannot tell you how much we appreciate it, Christine and Kurt. You guys have been awesome. And I can't wait to dig into these iBooks. And I think everybody else will, too. Anthony, Kelly, and Irene, do you have any questions for Kurt and Christine before we let them go? Go to sleep if they want to, or they can stick around if they want to.
Comments.
Okay. Hopefully, if anybody has any questions, we'll play around with iTunes, you guys, because there's so much in there and it's so underutilized, I think. Oh, yes. And if I could do a workshop, you know, at every conference I went to in iTunes U, I'm sure I would reach people who never even heard of it. I don't know why people don't dig around in there. It's awesome.
So if you guys are coming to ISTE this summer, Kurt and I will be there. We're doing a Joy of Professional Learning workshop on Saturday and then an iTools Academy on Sunday. And that's just really to see how all of the tools within the Apple ecosystem work together to create content for iTunes U. So it's really to see all of the aspects of that.
And are you guys doing the ADE Playground too?
Yep. And we're doing the iPlayground on Tuesday. So that's a chance to come and play. But if you really want to dive into kind of a good workshop, our iTools workshop, we had great success last year. We had about 30 participants, and by now we have about how many? 15,000 subscribers.
Yeah, that course went crazy.
That's crazy. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Oh my gosh. Wow. We're doing a playground at our ICE conference in about a month. So hopefully Carolyn will be there. And I haven't seen Carolyn. Her hair is so long. I haven't seen her in so long. Her hair is like really grown.
Skip it. It's adorable.
Yes, you look great.
All right. Well, thank you. Although no one can compete with the mighty haircut of you, Christine. So like, every time I see your cute short hair, I'm like, ooh, it's time.
It's so much fun to see you guys. I feel like we're like you're like next door.
Right? It's so great. Let's do this again.
Yeah. Yeah. If I can ever return the favor for you guys, if you need somebody to talk to people about anything, I'm more than happy to do that.
We would love that.
You guys have really extended yourselves for me. So I appreciate it. If you want to stick around, stick around. If you want to code collapse, I won't object. And
you didn't mean me. Sorry.
No, not you. You probably want to collapse too, Carolyn. But you don't have the jet lag. You're just tired from the long day at school, I bet.
It's regular old teaching stuff. You know how it goes.
Yeah.
But it is so nice to see you, Christine and Kurt. It's just to see your smiling face is very delightful.
Same.
All right.
Okay, we're going to sign off. Have a lovely next hour. And thank you so much, Lucy, for having us. Okay. It's been so much fun.
I'll send you the recording when we're done. Okay?
Great. Right.
Okay. Thank you. Awesome. Thank you guys are great.
Hope to see you guys again soon.
Same. Thanks so much. Nice to meet all of you.
Woohoo!
Bye.
So this is, like, we should do this every week. Like ADE, ADE galore, ADEs galore. So,
I know, it's like a family reunion. It's so lovely.
Yeah. So everyone, we have Kelly, who's a fourth grade teacher in the Burbs, Anthony, who works for NLU, and we have Irene, who has a cultural awareness after school program in CPS, and her kids go to school on the Northwest Side, so she's familiar with Chicago Public Schools. And everyone, this is my friend Carolyn Skibba, who is also an Apple Distinguished Educator, and she works at Burley. And what I find, Burley's at Lincoln, and I hear there's a Whole Foods going up by you. Humongous, right?
Yeah, absolutely gargantuan Whole Foods is going in right at the Lincoln Ashland Belmont intersection. So it's just a block north of our school. So,
oh, wow.
Yeah.
I hope they donate to your school for something.
Well, actually, they did fund our chicken coop. We have chickens at school now and a greenhouse as well. So it's pretty awesome. Like out in front, we have, I can't remember the exact number of chickens, but they've started producing enough eggs that we are able to start selling some of those to fundraise because as they say, it's not just chicken feed, although it is for the chicken feed, the fundraising with the eggs, but it's been a great experience for the kids. And Whole Foods, I think, really has reached out to neighborhood schools now that they're going to have this bigger presence. And they're really working to make sure that, that they are supporting sustainability and healthy eating and local foods and some of the things that are priorities for them.
Oh, cool.
That also benefit the kids.
Oh, that's great. That's great. So Burley's one of my favorite schools to visit because they have had this, and I'll let Carolyn talk about what they've been doing, but they've had this really sound pedagogical approach to integrating technology into the curriculum, which I think has driven everything. And when you go to the school, everything's very authentically done and purposeful, and it's not some big production. It's just they use technology in really clever, sometimes subtle ways, and I love what they do. And Carolyn has been there for how many years? 10 years? 11 years?
Oh, 18.
18? No, really? God,
yep, no, it's all true.
So you've really been there. You've really overseen kind of the various phases that you guys have gone through with tech. She's also an Apple Distinguished Educator, as I mentioned before. And Carolyn, will you be at ICE this February?
I will be at ICE. Sue Gorman and I are doing a workshop on Wednesday on iPads and creativity. And then on Thursday, I'm going to be facilitating an iMovie and storytelling session in the playground.
Oh, good.
And so, yeah, so that'll be really fun. So I'll be there Wednesday and then Thursday.
Okay. Well. I know Kelly's coming, so maybe she'll come stalk you. And we have some other students that are coming as well. Anyway, I'm gonna let Carolyn introduce herself and get going with things. And this course is really focused on professional development. We have people in it who may be professional developers at some point, other people who have to take this course to graduate. Some of the people will be watching this after the fact rather than during it. One of them, you may have met Corey, he was an ISTE young educator. He was at a school that was one-to-one iPad, and now he's at Lake Forest High School. You may have met him before. He's in this course. Corey Holmer. I don't know if you've met him.
I don't think so. The name sounds familiar, okay, though. But
cool. Yeah, so he could probably teach this course. I bet some of these people could probably teach the course, in fact. And then we have some people who a lot of this is really new to them, but I think they're learning a lot. And for the last couple of weeks, I've invited friends in to talk about what they're passionate about with staff development, that sort of thing. And everything's kind of magically come together. Everything is kind of, it's been really good. And ideally, people will get ideas from these sessions and then apply it to their benchmark project that they do at the end of the course. So I want them to tap your brains and think outside of the box when they design their experiences. So that's our end goal.
Cool. Okay. Well, I think that my school, I mean, can we talk general PD, or is it all technology related, or is it kind of a little bit of everything?
We can do anything. I don't care. I mean, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they'll jump in. These guys are not shy. They'll ask questions. They can unmute anytime they want to.
Yeah, totally. Go for it anytime.
Or go in the chat and, you know, anything that's related. I mean, Anthony's experiences are a little different because he's the technology, academic technology guy at National Lewis. So he's a little bit in a different scenario. They're all in very different scenarios, but you know, he's working mostly with adults who are sound a little bit reluctant sometimes. Kelly's working with kids and is already kind of invested in this world that we're talking about. And Irene is running a business essentially, but has to do staff development with the people that work for her. So I think anything that you say is going to be useful to a certain degree. So anyway, I'll shut up.
Yeah, no, it's just, awesome. I mean, it sounds, sorry.
I thought you were muted. Go ahead.
No, please go ahead. I was, there was a lag and I couldn't tell what was going on. Proceed.
I was just going to make a quick comment saying, yeah, it's a little bit intimidating because I do a lot of professional development and I work with individuals who are a lot of times are a lot older than I am and also a lot more credentialed than I am. So professional educators, you know, with doctorates in education, and here I am, you know, some guy that's been working for National Lewis for 2 years. But I guess it's okay because, you know, I think I'm pretty good at what I do. So I do a lot of D2L administration. So I do D2L training and things like that. And, you know, a lot of the educators I work with are, you know, especially with NLU, with adjunct educators. So these adjuncts are, you know, business professionals and people who are outside working, you know, in the workplace and are not necessarily education professionals. So I think I have a little bit of some unique insights to share with them when they come to my trainings.
The other piece of it too is, what was I going to say about the adult piece? I know what I was going to say. The coaching aspect, we could talk a little bit about that because I think Carolyn's very good at coaching other teachers too, and she might want to talk about how she works with her faculty in particular. The next couple of weeks we're going to start focusing on the coaching piece. This is part of the course that I have to completely rewrite. And we're using a book from ISTE, which I'm not sure if I'm sold on, but it's a good guide. It's called Effective Digital Learning Environments, and it's your guide to the ISTE standards for coaches. And so that's, we're going to be looking over that a little bit in the next few weeks, just FYI, Carolyn. Cool. So anyway, I'll shut up really now.
It's always nice to hear from you, Lucy. I was like, I could listen to Lucy all day. She always has these little smart things to kind of sprinkle in it. I don't know that book, so I'm curious to check that out. Although, I mean, I know you're giving it a mixed review, but it's always good to have additional perspective. And I think a lot of us face those situations where we're dealing with people who have different skill sets or more expertise maybe with the curriculum, but haven't had a lot of exposure or experience to framing it from a digital perspective, a technology integration perspective. I want to take a little moment, if I may, to just sort of tell the story of our school, because I think that from a professional development standpoint, what we do at our school is really unique. And I think understanding that context helps provide some understanding of kind of how we've approached technology professional development at Burley. So is it okay if I kind of launch into the Burley story for a couple minutes here?
Absolutely.
All right, cool. So Burley is a Chicago public school. We are in Lakeview. We've got about 510 students now. When I started, we had about 360. And, share screen, good tidbit. All right, cool. And actually I do have a website I'll show in just a minute. So Burley is a school that really went through a very comprehensive and effective internal turnaround process starting in the mid-90s. And so there's sort of this legendary meeting at Burley School where in the mid-90s, this is before I was hired, but not tons before, a group of teachers got together and they were looking through their student data. And they were realizing that the longer students stayed at Burley, the worse they did. And the legend of this meeting involves a lot of tears, a lot of frustration, a lot of hand-wringing over the fact that people are saying, we are all working so hard. These were dedicated, caring professional educators, but the results simply were not there. And so what they did at the time was they wrote a grant. And I don't remember the specifics of the grant. Again, it's all kind of fading into lore now that this is over 20 years old. But I do have colleagues who still know the details, as well as our retired principal, who loves, loves, loves to tell this story. It might be another cool person for you to connect with, Lucy, about professional development, because I think she has such a powerful vision in this area. But the grant was really for teachers to sit down and really take a deep look at reading and writing curriculum and to really say, what are the core practices that we believe are going to make a difference for kids? And they read professional books, they got curriculum maps, they got standards from different states, and they just sort of spread it all out in a room over the summer and went digging. And out of that emerged a list of core competencies in language arts that really formed the backbone of a teacher-authored curriculum. And that one grant, that one experience, sort of defined the philosophy that guides all our professional development to this day. So our school really believes in teacher research, really believes in teacher-led professional development, really believes in ideas being generated from teams of teachers sitting together and looking at student work, looking at professional texts together, looking at available tools and resources, and things really coming from the ground up. And so one of sort of the core pieces of our professional development as a school is called Teachers as Readers. And so ever since, I want to say this started in maybe 2001, 2002, we have engaged in professional study together where the whole faculty will read something by Nancy Atwell or by Lucy Calkins or by Stephanie Harvey and Smokey Daniels and really look at developing our own philosophy of teaching and building cohesiveness around our values as a staff and around how we want to approach this daily adventure with the kids and really making learning more authentic, more joyful, ditching things like basils and workbooks and using authentic writing, quality literature, student curiosity as sort of the underpinning for everything. And I think this is only possible, and this gets directly to the technology piece in a minute, I swear. But I think this kind of curriculum is only possible when teachers are really empowered to assemble and synthesize learning from not only their own day-to-day experience, but also professional resources and professional texts. And so it's a very grassroots kind of approach. And it really means that we as a staff have beliefs that are not classroom to classroom. They are school-wide, passionately held beliefs that are based on shared values that have emerged through our professional literature. And so when technology, you know, when I started at Burley, we had some like LC580s and some Quadras and stuff like that, like some super old Macs, a couple in the room. And like, we bought these weird things to like cook them up so we could be on the internet sort of, and use HyperCard and like cool stuff like that. And so, Irene, I don't know, I might have to make a commentary about that. I don't know. I was reading her comment in the chat. She should come visit. Because I think that it's important to look at school progress, but also individual teacher progress as a teacher-driven process and not something we're going to do to teachers and to schools. When I hear about schools being turned around and everybody firing the whole faculty and just like, you know, coming in with some sort of program and being like, well, this program's aligned to the test, and if we all implement it with fidelity, will our scores will go up. Sure, that might be true to a certain point, but it's like, if you don't have teacher buy-in and teacher expertise, you're really building a house of cards, in my opinion. And so, so in any case, when technology became more of a prominent part of our world, we had the opportunity through the district, through Chicago Public Schools, to become a technology magnet cluster school. So I don't know if it's worth getting into all this, because this is just like background, and I know we've got a finite time. But at the end, the essence is that we were already a literature and writing magnet cluster school, which means we're still a neighborhood school with our neighborhood attendance boundaries. We have this curricular emphasis in this area of expertise in literature and writing. And so, all right, Lucy says just go, so I'm just going to go. Okay, and so we had the opportunity to add a technology designation to that. And there was a lot of hesitation about that, because we're like, you know, our heart and soul is really reading and writing, and it's really amazing books, and it's read aloud for every child, and it's independent reading, and it's having workshop and having kids as authentic writers and things like that. And what we decided together was that adding technology as a piece had to hook into this philosophy, had to hook into these shared beliefs, or it had no place in our school. So I think people looked at it and said, we are wary, and understandably wary, because they're like, we have something really special here. And sometimes I feel that technology comes in as sort of this add-on, or this something that's going to take over and say, okay, now we're going to all be rolling out whatever these, I don't want to like badmouth any particular software programs, because I'm not knowledgeable about them. But I think people think that it's a program that you can buy rather than a tool that you can use to enhance student thinking. And so we were lucky, I don't know if lucky is the right word, but our whole approach to technology PD is about how can we use new tools for what they are uniquely good at to further our existing curricular goals, but also add new goals that we didn't know were possible before. So like in terms of student collaboration and publishing for an authentic audience, things like that. So I think even in a situation where, you know, Burley's very unique, I feel in this history, it's a shame, because I do feel like this is a model that could be replicable, very replicable in terms of schools doing an internal turnaround process and really looking at shared values and professional research and student needs, and then putting those together to build something cohesive and effective. But in any case, I know of many other schools and many other districts where the technology is coming in at a point where the curriculum is also at loose ends. So for us, our curriculum was like, and the technology came along and kind of helped bolster it. Shared values, student needs, and professional research. Yeah, you got to have that one in there. That's good stuff. But I think there are a lot of schools and districts where the situation is such that the curriculum has been kind of formulaic, textbook driven, things like that. And the technology comes along and really sort of opens a window to do things that the textbook based curriculum can't. So a really good example, I feel, is when we look at like the current standards for mathematical practice, and you're looking at students being able to articulate their math thinking, and you're looking at students being able to understand and critique and evaluate different approaches to problem solving. I don't know a better way of doing that than having kids screencast and explain their mathematical thinking and then participate in a digital community about math problem solving. And so it's like when you find, you know, it's like if the standards and the expectations of the curriculum is kind of too weak to address it, I feel that finding the place where the technology offers something new that's going to do it better can be such a great inroad. This kind of goes back to the Anthony's comment about before about coaching and about finding something that people are going to say, wow, I really do need that. Or when I look at just a student's finished work, I don't know enough about what they're thinking, but if they can record themselves explaining it, then I know a lot more. So in any case, that's a lot of background and then a lot of opinionating. There are a couple of cool things I feel that we have done at Burley for technology professional development. Certainly the, using professional texts has been a bit more of a challenge for us because, I mean, recently a couple of great books have been published that we've been able to look at as a staff. Also by Heinemann, I know you put in the link to Smokey Daniels and to his work, but a couple of former Burley teachers, Kristen Zemke and Katie Mataris, have written a couple of great books supporting comprehension toolkit practices through technology and really strengthening that. But since we didn't have access to a book, what we try to do is to look at tools that we know are going to offer something different and more effective and more powerful to the kids, have people exposed to some hands-on time to play with those, and then really think about where are the curriculum points where we're going to find a good match for what this tool can uniquely do and what we know that our kids need and that our curriculum demands. And so I think the playtime is such a critical piece of that. I almost feel that the playtime kind of is almost takes the place of the professional reading in a way, because when you're playing with a tool and you're having that sort of hands-on exposure to it, you know, if you're a reflective teacher and if you're given some support for reflecting as you're doing it and saying, okay, what do I notice about my own thought process as I'm doing this? What kind of stumbling blocks am I running into? What kind of decision-making am I engaged in? What am I creating? Who could I be creating it for? Where in my curriculum could this be a different kind of fit? And so for us, it's almost like play is the text for a lot of our professional learning around technology. And we did a, let me see if I can share my screen if that's going to work here. Dun, 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 dun. Okay, let's see if this happens. All right, are you guys seeing that? All right, cool. So this is, I can't see the chat window anymore, so someone's going to have to like just, I don't know.
Yeah, it's working. Yeah, it's
okay,
working.
Cool.
It's like, it looks great. That looks awesome. And you, I like this. Ooh, okay.
Well, this is old now, okay? So we did this a couple summers ago. I can't remember exactly the year, but this website's still online. It's burleytechcamp.weebly.com. Be alert because some of these apps that are on here are no longer apps that we recommend. They're apps that have changed in terms of their functionality since we ran this experience. But we really wanted to expose teachers in a fun way to the cycle of creating and sharing with iPads. And so this was something that was really important to us because we're like, this is the heart of how our kids use technology. They make stuff, they share it, they comment, they reflect, they participate, they interact. And we were like, we need to have our own hands-on experience like this so we can understand a little more about what the kids are going through. I think this is often one of the technology gaps is that people feel like, well, I can tell the kids to do it, but I don't really understand how to do it. I think if you have not tried yourself to make whatever the kids are going to make, I think you're setting yourself up for a little bit of heartache. And so the camp was designed to give people that kind of playtime so they would know how it went in the role of the student. And so anyway, so our camp, you know, you can read this website on your own, but basically we set up a private kid blog for teachers and we asked them to undertake 8 of 10 challenges. So these were the different challenges. Oh yeah, like audio boo, that's not happening anymore. I'm trying to think what else is on here that's changed. I mean, the rest of these are legit things that we definitely still use. But the idea was for people to just make some stuff. It was not curriculum related stuff. This was summer. We wanted people to have fun. We had people posting pictures of their frozen margaritas or whatever it might've been. But the idea was to experience being in a digital community, posting different types of media. It was also amazing because that year we had a couple of brand new staff members. And by the time they came in the fall, we felt like we knew them because we'd seen pictures of them and their family and heard their voices before school even started. So in any case, people had the whole summer to engage in these different challenges. So I'll show you an example. So let's go here to drawing pad. And to take these challenges, and there was sort of a to-do, and we had a committee of teachers. So this is my friend and colleague, Nick Giacobbe, who's completely amazing and wonderful. And so we spelled out what's the challenge. So for this one, today we're going to create a drawing of something that represents summer for you. It can be anything that means summer, glasses of lemonade, 4th of July fireworks, a beach in Fiji, etc. To share, you'll create a kid blog post about your experience featuring your artwork. The text of the post will include your thoughts about using the tools and drawing pad to make a picture that is quintessentially summer. And so we'd give them a PDF, some screenshots, we'd give them some steps to go through, and then we would invite them to complete this challenge and post to the blog, and we would see everybody's drawing come in, but they'd also have the experience of, wow, I now understand what it'd be like for a kid to make a drawing and share it to a blog, just technically how it works, as well as frustrations and opportunities brought about by the process of drawing and painting on the iPad. So we knew that there were some people who would be super techie go-getters. And so we created the Arts and Crafts Shed. Oh, it says my internet connection is unstable. Are you seeing that message? That's a dramatic message. All right, cool. So the Arts and Crafts Shed was for people who already knew all those apps really well and were like, oh, I can't make another, you know, I don't want to waste my time on Pic Collage. I already know that so well. And so this was, wow, I really know this other app, or I know how to make this thing, or I've always wanted to play with this tool. And so then people would go to the Arts and Crafts Shed and they would just make a post basically on whatever they wanted. We just named it a shed because we thought it was cute. And and who doesn't love a shed? Then we also knew on the other end of the spectrum that we were going to have teachers who could not do this sitting at home. They really needed a little more in-person support. And so we had what we called campfire days, where people could come to school and we would have members of the technology committee there to like all sit together and we'd all order lunch and we'd go through the challenges together and just have a good time. We actually didn't have a huge demand for those, but we did have some teachers who came to the campfire days, and I think we're pleased to be able to work through it with a buddy. We tried to really delineate for people what to put in their blog posts, but they were short. We did also include a recipe for delicious s'mores bars, which I baked and served. That's totally optional in your professional development experiences, but I do find that home baked goods are, you know, help the learning go down real nice. So just a little side tip there. But in any case, that was our tech camp. And it was fun and it was great. And I'm hoping we will do another one. So that was that. Does anybody have any questions about that one? I have a couple of things that I could talk about a little bit as well if people are interested, but I'm going to open the chat back up just in case there's anything in there. I don't know where.
Yeah, I think you can take yourself out of full screen if you go to the top of the screen when you're sharing, but I could be wrong. Kelly's asking, how did you show the badges? So do you use a badging system or anything?
So we did, but we didn't have any kind of, and honestly, I'm a little unclear on the whole badge thing, to be honest. We did it as a certificate. So we made these really cute certificates and printed stickers on round labels and just gave everybody, I wonder if I have mine in handy. So we gave them a certificate. So we had a, what do we call it? We definitely called it like a jamboree or something like that at the end when we came back to school all together and we read blog posts and we looked at them and we did a reflection and we made like a little fake campfire out of little frou-frou stuff and it was fun. And that was where the s'mores bars came in. My colleague Todd found all this awesome campfire music that we listened to. But other than the fact that it was fun, so like connecting to what I'm sure Christine and Kurt talked about making professional learning joyful. It was fun and it's fun to have a theme and it's fun to have food. But I think people felt a lot of flexibility and a lot of opportunity to kind of go as far or as beginning level as they were comfortable with. Oh, how do we encourage that? Oh, there was a prize. So we had iPad minis for teachers who completed all the challenges. So that's quite a substantial prize. That's something that we would certainly never be in current budget times ever to offer again. But we knew that teachers who were teaching with iPads needed an iPad anyway. And we really wanted to say, look, if you're going to be using these tools with your kids, it's part of your professional opportunity and responsibility to get to know what it's like to be a kid making stuff on an iPad. So even though this was sort of a baseline expectation, we also really wanted to make it fun. And so the badges went out on a paper certificate. So you get one sticker for each challenge you completed. And then we also had ones, special awards for people who left lots of comments for others. Special stickers for people who are counselors who are willing to advise and support others. I can't remember our other stickers because this was a couple years ago. As far as choosing the challenges and making them relevant to the teachers who are participating, so let me go back to the website real quick. Share screen, Tech Camp, share screen. Okay, I guess you don't need to hear me narrate all that. So the challenges were really meant to just expose teachers to a core suite of very flexible, creative digital tools. So what we wanted was to lay a foundation and a groundwork of a variety of image, audio, video-based tools that aren't one-purpose apps, but that people could really use across the curriculum. So the challenges were tool-based, they weren't curriculum-based. So in terms of relevance, we wanted to make sure it was something that would be super flexible and suitable for teachers at any level, teaching any subject. And then the challenges themselves, we just wanted to keep it light and simple and social. And so again, we wanted people to play and we wanted people to try out the tools. And so we were like, okay, for Sonic Picks, we just want you to go in and make different, take different images and narrate and tell us about some of the foods and drinks of summer. And so it says, we just wanted people to take three pictures of something nice you've had to eat or drink over the summer, and then people would tell about them. And so we got some fabulous restaurant recommendations this way, which was delightful. But it was also just really about, again, what is it like to choose images? What's it like to narrate those images? How does viewing these different than viewing just a blog post with text and images? How might that support kids differently? Things like that. And so the summer part was all just play and fun and based on things like going to the beach and seeing a nature scene, or what are you reading this summer, or whatever it might be. And then it was really when we came back to school that then I was able to use as the tech coach. This was a year when I was mostly a freed tech coach, with the exception of a couple of grade levels. Now I'm back to teaching all the tech classes for K-8 and doing the coaching, which is a separate topic. Wonderful also. But we tried when we came back to really tie the coaching and subsequent professional development sessions back into the experiences from camp. So let me go back out of... Sorry, I've not used this before, and for some reason, I'm like a little clumsy with it. I apologize. Let me go back in the chat here.
It's all right. It's not. I like it actually. Zoom has been a pretty good platform for us for this class.
Yeah, no, it's nice. I haven't used it, but it seems really reasonable. Extra badges for counselors. They had all summer. Yeah, so they had all summer to do this. And so definitely we had some people like me who posted all their things like 2 days before we had to return back to school. We had the super organized people who were like, oh, I'm going to do one a week all summer long. And I'm like, that's cute. That's totally not my style. I'm a major 11th hour person. but we were just like, you know, it's your summertime. We're not going to tell you what to do or how to do it. There were people who didn't finish at all. And so what they did is when they came back to the PD session in the fall, they did not receive the incentive, but they did have a login for the blog, and they were able to go through with their team and look at, wow, I can see how this app allows students to annotate photos. How could I maybe use that in my curriculum and still engage in that planning process, even though they hadn't had the fun and the hands-on over the summer? Sadly, we don't do it every summer. again, I'm hoping we can do it again this summer. But as Irene, I think it is, you're in Chicago Public Schools, right? So you know what a weird and difficult time this is for us. And we just felt like last summer, we didn't want to put it on people's plates, even though it was fun and delightful. I think the social aspects of it are so valuable. And I feel that this is something I would also like to do during the school year because, yeah, as you likely know, Chicago Public Schools has eliminated all of our professional development time, all of it. And so the very few days we had remaining to be together are gone. Our school still has our teachers as readers time before school because we opted to flex schedule a couple of the end of year PD days and cut them up so they would be pieced out across the year on our Tuesday mornings. But as far as opportunity to run technology sessions, we have nothing left anymore. And I would love to offer another thing like this because, you know, people do want to learn. People do want to connect with their colleagues. And I think when there's very little time for that kind of face-to-face connection, something like this can help people feel a little less isolated and also have a little bit of fun with their colleagues. And I would probably just have to buy people Snickers bars or something for the incentive because we're not buying any more fun. Fun iPads for people. So yeah, no PD time. So we used to have in CPS, we used to all begin work half an hour before the school day started so we could have morning meetings, morning collaboration, morning book study. I could run like little app drop-in sessions, whatever it might be. And then we used to have, I can't even remember how many professional development days spread over the course of the year. Now we only have 4 over the course of the year. And the last one in February, as well as the one that we were planning to have at the end of the third quarter, as well as the end of school year days have now been swept from the calendar as furlough days. So as of early February, or was it late January, the district basically decided that no staff would have any time together, all together in a room, and again, until September. So it's terrible. It is completely crazy. And I feel that something like the tech camp, again, provides a window. You know, we still have principal directed preps where grade level teams get together and are able to meet, but that's a small group, the same small group of teachers meeting over and over and over. But if they were engaged in something like this during that time, at least we'd be building that conversation across the school. And sadly, I can't share the blog because I promised teachers, I was like, this is going to be completely private to Burley School and nobody else will ever see it. But it was really nice. It was casual. And I'm glad you mentioned 21 Things. I'm embarrassed I did not give that a shout out because that was originally one of the ideas that I had wanted to implement. When I heard about it at the ICE conference, actually several years ago, and that idea morphed into the tech camp idea. So that idea definitely inspired this tech camp approach. And yes, partner schools need a happy hour, Irene. Thumbs up on that. I don't even know. I'm trying to think professional development wise. I mean, I think we have tried to get really crafty with time to the greatest extent that we can. I do a lot of co-teaching with people like on my preps. And when I have openings, I do have a couple extra periods beyond just the mandated 5 preps a week when I can get into people's rooms and do things like that. I see the question about Seesaw or Google Classroom. I think Seesaw would be amazing because I think for people to experience, especially, you know, at the beginning we were talking about people who are very reluctant. When people realize that you can do everything in Seesaw itself, you don't even have to use additional apps. But if you start off just using all the different features of Seesaw, it is so incredible. And I think it just blows people's minds how much they can do within that one tool. And when they see that even little guys could do it, and then you can work in the layer of having the learning journal versus having the blog. So different layers of privacy and things like that for student sharing. It is to me, that is one of those absolute no-brainer tools, really for any age. You know, I know a lot of people feel like it's very, very primary, But we've had older students use it as well, and it's just so simple. And the fact that it's so cross-platform is really, really pretty compelling. So,
Carolyn, could you talk a little bit about, are you still involved with ICE CAP?
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit about your involvement with ICE? And then I know this is not directly related to PD, but I love your If They Learned Here project. And I don't know.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, that's just getting started. We just got 3 new registrations today. We're so excited.
Oh, okay. So talk about those 2 things before. I want to make sure that we end at 8. So that would be awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, cool. And if anyone has any other things that that you're wondering about before we hit 8 o'clock, pop it into the chat and we'll plow through that also. I'm sorry, I'm kind of like a long-winded person. So I hope what I'm sharing is helpful and useful to you guys. Okay, ICE CAP. So since this is an Illinois course, ICE, as you know, is Illinois Computing Educators, our fabulous state affiliate of ISTE, and ICE CAP is the Chicago chapter. And so I've been on the ICE CAP board for several years now, and we have really thought a lot about what kind of content to offer ICE CAP members, as well as other teachers around Chicago. And initially, we were really trying to go with things that we felt people were desperate for, and meaning like aim for people who were saying, oh, my principal keeps telling me that there are documents in Drive I'm supposed to be using, but I don't know what Drive is, and I don't know how to get there or what it is. So we would aim for sort of a lot of very beginner content. And then we realized, and this was, you know, a few years ago, that even though there is a very, very real need for that, and we certainly want to make sure that people who are just trying to get up to speed can keep their heads above water, I think to keep an organization going and to keep momentum going, you always want people who are sort of pushing the edges also of what's possible and really making, innovating and doing things that are really cool. And so this year we have tried to add a feature called ICE CAPing to the ICE CAP schedule. So again, in the past we did mostly mini conferences, which were run like conferences. We'd have concurrent sessions at different levels and people would sign up and they would go. And we still do those and we think they're great. ICE CAPing is a little more play-based and a little more social. We do try to host them at establishments where people can order the beverage of their choice. And so we've had them at a few bar and grills around Chicago. And we provide some snackies and people come in and they order something to drink and do some mixing and mingling, which we kind of loosely structure. And then we do demo slams or mini presentations or mini playgrounds. We just had one last Thursday that was actually hosted by BitSpace on Lawrence near... between Rockwell and Western, 2500 block of West Lawrence. BitSpace is like a makerspace for kids. They run camps and field trips and they'll come to your school and run an after school club. It was really cool. But they did an Arduino session for us. So we're always kind of playing with how can we make these sessions fun? Again, fun, because everyone is so tired. Again, especially in CPS, everybody's struggling. So how can we make it fun? How can we make it relevant? How can we balance sort of the survival techniques with innovation and inspiration? Because I think it's great to be able to keep your head above water, sometimes you want to fly a little bit too, you know? And so, or at least just be exposed to what's out there and what's possible, not just how many get through day to day and, send assignments to kids and get the work back. That's important too, but that can't be everything. So ICE CAP, the other thing I want to mention, Lucy, this didn't come up yet, is a play date, which, again, if you're noticing sort of a play theme, we haven't run a play date in several years. So play date, I was on the committee that helped organize the first play date. I am certainly not the founder of that idea. It was Anita Huffman and Autumn Laidler, and I believe Jenny McGarrah was with them, and Sue Gorman, and they were coming back from a conference, and they, there it is, you found her. You are so good, Lucy, with the links, and they were coming back from a conference and saying, I just want a conference where all we do is we all get together with smart people and play with stuff that we've always wanted to have time to play with, and that was basically the idea of Playdate, and Playdate is an acronym for, people learn and ask why, digital age teacher exploration or something like that. And those were events that, again, were, it's sort of a an ed camp linked sort of idea. I don't know if you've talked about ed camps much yet, Lucy. But the idea is basically that people who want to learn a tool can get together in the room with other people who want to learn the tool. And there's someone there to just sort of facilitate, but like nobody's really there presenting. You're just like, wow, I've always wanted to play around with Scratch. And you go online and you crowdsource a document with tutorials and resources and you try stuff out. And that I think is 99% of how any of us learn how to use technology anyway, is by trying it out and playing with it. And so we create an event to do that. It was super fun. We haven't run one in a while. I know the idea got picked up in you know, in different places around the country and a few other countries in the world even. And that people are still running play dates out there. We just haven't done one in a while. But I think that hands-on element, the importance of that cannot be overstated. I think if people don't, if people are passive and just sort of assigning it to the kids and not experiencing it in the role of the student, I think it takes some of the joy out of it. I think it takes some of the empowerment out of it. And I think it takes some of the ability for the teacher to really find the sweet spot for where to use the digital tool. If you've tried it, you know what it's good for and you know what the outcome's going to look like. And you're in a much better position, I think, to make good planning decisions, good instructional decisions about technology for your kids. So anyway, that's my main plug for playing. And since Lucy was asking, I will just share, just because this is fun and cool. Gosh, I would love to do a count of how many times we can say fun. See, teaching is the funnest job. Okay, so let me share my screen one more time. And I will go back here to this window, but this is not the window that I actually want to be in. I want to be, okay. So my friend Mary Morgan Ryan, who teaches at Oak School in Hinsdale, she's a librarian there and she's brilliant and wonderful. And she has a very, very incredible podcast that you should check out that I do not have the link to off the top of my head in the next 4 minutes. But If You Learned Here is a global collaboration and authoring project. We are now in our third year of running this. And so in previous years, we have had two global books published. By published, I mean we have published them in Book Creator, a wonderful, wonderful app. And we have also had students engaging in international conversations about their schools, about their learning, and so on. And it's been a great deal of fun. This year, we have really been reflecting on the nature of global collaboration and its purpose in a world where I think the value of diversity is sometimes in question. And so we are completely changing the format to make it more student-centered and to have more student voices represented. And so this year, we're going to begin by publishing our global book. We're going to use that global book for schools around the world to read it and to generate questions about other cultures and other schools. We're going to post those questions to Flipgrid, and then the kids around the world are just going to answer them. And then we're going to have some facilitated wrap up, but it's really going to be about kids asking and answering questions in a short video format and engaging in a thoughtful kind of way with kids around the world. So we're super pumped about it. So keep an eye on that website because we're starting soon. So we're going to be posting content very soon.
So you're looking for people. So I'll publicize it and let people know.
Yeah, we are maxed out for Illinois though, so Please no more Illinois friends, even though we love our friends and neighbors.
Okay.
I don't know if we're able to accept. We might have room for like one or two more U.S. schools outside the Midwest. Okay. But otherwise, we are looking at this point just for more international participants, okay. Although we're about 50-50 at this point.
Okay. So you went back to Flipgrid because you were using Seesaw last year. Right.
We did go back to Flipgrid. So Flipgrid, for people who haven't used it, is it limits the responses to 90 seconds. And we also felt that people were putting too much time into the production value of their videos rather than just hearing kids talk and hearing kids share their thinking. And we think Flipgrid's going to facilitate that sort of more direct interaction. a little bit better, you know, just between kids sharing their thoughts. So we're excited to see how it goes. We have not done the crowdsourced questions. We did predetermined themes, and then we felt like that didn't really reflect our values for the project. So we're going to have kids around the world tell us what they want to know, and we're going to probably combine like questions and maybe broaden the questions a little so that they're more answerable by a broad range of kids. But all the questions this year are going to be student generated, so we're really excited.
I wonder if teachers could tie this into work around, you know, getting kids to ask good questions too. I think there's an art to it. And when I worked with Falconer School a couple years ago, we practiced questions using a protocol from something called the Right Question Institute, which is a group based in Cambridge. And it helped. We did this in preparation to do a video chat with an author of a book that these kids had read. And I thought it was the Right Question Institute had kind of a, you know, easy stuff to follow that you could incorporate into your everyday lessons to get kids to think about whether they were asking good questions or not. So
cool. That's a great resource. Interesting. Yeah.
Anyway, I think I love this project because A, you were structured. B, you know, the expectations are clearly put out for people. It doesn't take forever. It doesn't consume, you know, all day in a classroom. It's, you know, it's, there's a low barrier, you know, to entry with this. And then, I liked how there was this kind of end product and celebration, you know, with the past 2 years that you've done with this. And if only everybody kind of thought out their global projects like this, you know, then we'd have, you know, we've tried, you guys have been my inspiration to get more people to be thoughtful and intentional about, I haven't talked to you in a long time, so I'll show you this. To be thoughtful and intentional with the global projects that they do. And so we did let me see if I can find it. Excuse me. We had we've done something called the Great Global Project Challenge. And we have a contest going on right now. It's too late to enter, but it was like the entry was open from like June till December, and then the projects are taking place now. And then and the idea was that they create something with those characteristics that like in your project, and I cite your project as an example. And then there's going to be a committee of people reviewing these, and then the 10 winning classrooms will get a $1,500 grant for professional development or something leading to additional project-based learning. So hopefully we'll do it again next year if we get a sponsor for it with my Global Ed Conference. So
that's awesome.
But yeah, I think this is, there's an art to design these projects well, you know, so it ends up being actually beneficial to people.
I think so too. I mean, I think it's like, it's not just enough to just sit down and be like, hi, we're in Chicago. Hi, we're in Japan. And it's like, okay. It's like, you know, you want to have some meat to it. You want to have some structure. You want to have it meaningful, but also very, very manageable, I think. So, but I mean, I think that also goes along with the PD. You know, it's like, I feel like some of those same principles are things to keep in mind for anyone who wants to do like an online experience, like a tech camp. It's got to be clear what you're supposed to do. It's got to be clear what the outcomes are, the objectives, the time commitment, the tools. You got to have tutorials to go with the tools, you know, all that stuff. So,
Irene, do you want to jump in before we wrap up? Do you want to, you can turn on your microphone and talk, or go for it. Introduce yourself and tell us what you've been doing with Global, and then we'll wrap up.
Hi, I don't really know what to add anymore, but yeah, I could probably reach out to some of these schools. I have to read through what the link is about, but I have it bookmarked here, so I'll definitely be able to take a look.
And I can give you the quick 10-second overview, which is basically the project is going to run from, we're starting on Thursday, we're going to be sending out welcome packets to the teachers, which are going to have like a door sign for their classroom and a how to post PDF for that they can post for their kids and a sign they can hold up to identify their school and has their country's flag and things like that on it. And then people are going to have till March 3rd to publish their pages for the book and to start doing some brainstorming with their kids. And then people are going to read our global book with their kids and say, what are you wondering? And we're going to provide resources for questioning and things like that. And then from March 13th to 31st, so that half a month, We're going to be putting a bunch of questions in Flipgrid, and kids are just going to be can go around to a computer in the classroom or to their devices, post
Froze on me.
Yeah, it froze on me too.
Carolyn, come back.
I think it just might be Carolyn's.
All right, let's see if she comes. Let's give her a second here. Yeah, this project they've been doing for 3 years, and it's I just think it's really well done, and a really great example. There she is. Are you back? You're muted.
I know. I was talking away, and next thing I know, I looked up at my Wi-Fi thing, and it's all gray, and I was like, oh, well, this is not going well at all. Sorry.
Well, we'll wrap up. Just tell us, can you remember what you were talking about?
I don't even know where I was. All I know is my son's probably doing something online downstairs that's interfering with my success here.
That's probably happening in my house, too.
Oh, that happens, as we know. Yeah. Where was I?
You were talking about the project, and you were sending out the welcome packets and things like that on Thursday.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the bottom line is it's only about 6 weeks long. People can kind of jump in anytime between now and, I would say, like February 24th, because by March 3rd, they have to produce book pages. And the book pages are short. It's one per school. But just to give people a text that we can all read to get some basic information about each other to inspire our questioning. And then those questions are just going to be there on Flipgrid, and you can have 3 students respond or 30 students respond or whatever you want to do. And everyone's going to hold up their flag so you can scan through visually and see where are these responses from, and listen and learn from kids all over the world and from their thinking. And we're going to provide supports for the questioning as well as for helping your kids synthesize what it is they're hearing.
And you can awesome. Download the books from previous years and look at them too. So that's yes. What's kind of fun, I think, to see how this project has morphed and changed over the years.
Yeah, okay. And we're changing the book template a little this year, but Lucy, you said we'd be done at 8, and I want to keep people here because that's not a way for me to make friends with all of your nice students.
I know. We're having a good time with this. This has actually been the best part of the course, has been having these conversations, I think, because awesome. I think this is the way people learn. They don't learn from other people's experiences, not reading some textbook, as we've pointed out earlier. So I can't wait to see what people are coming up with because for the benchmark projects, because every single person has contributed something valuable to kind of, you know, I don't know, to help us be more creative. So I'll be sure to share whatever people come up with. I'll make sure that they are okay with me sharing it with you. But I'd like to send our speakers whatever we come up with, so they get an idea of what was generated as a result of these talks. So
yeah, that sounds awesome. And I mean, if anybody wants to borrow any of the, I mean, I don't own the text on that tech camp. So if anyone wants to borrow any of the ideas on there, or, you know, it's the format, whatever you want to do. I mean, it's not, you know, something I made for school. It's there to be shared. So if anyone's
I think it's nice if you cite it, if you do borrow it, cite it, or, you know, mention it somewhere so people know. I think that's.
Oh yeah. Don't like steal it, but you know, but it's like, I mean, it's not, I should actually put a license on there to let people know, because it's there to benefit teachers, however many that might be, you know.
It's great. It was wonderful. Okay. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Carolyn. You've been fabulous. I can't wait to see you and catch up. It's been a long time. I will see you at ICE for sure. And I appreciate you sharing your time after a long day at school and everything. And hopefully things will look up in CPS one of these days.
They either will or they won't, but it's always fun to be with the kids. So yeah. Can't complain about that.
I know. Burleigh is an awesome school. And thanks, Kelly, Irene, and Anthony for coming. I really appreciate it. I will post the recording of this in our course. I'll send it to you, Carolyn, as well. And that's all for tonight, everyone. I'm going to stop recording.